I'm Rod Serling.
You unlock this door with the key of imagination. Beyond it is another dimension. A dimension of sound, a dimension of sight, a dimension of mind. You're moving into a land of both shadow and substance, of things and ideas. You've just crossed over into the Twilight Zone.
Roswell G. Flemington Model Ship Company. I'll check. Please hold. Did we fill the Benson order yet?
Benson? I just packed it. Scale model steamship complete with working boiler and drive propellers. It's going out today. COD.
Mr. Benson, your ship's been shipped. Mailed. You should get it by the end of the week. That's right. You're welcome.
Lloyd, where's the ledger from last quarter?
Well, on the top bookshelf.
Why'd you put it all the way up there by the ceiling?
I didn't. Flemington did.
Oh, then let's move the ladder so I can get up the flying jib or whatever he calls the wall beam.
The mast. The captain insists it's the mast.
Now don't you go nautical on me, Lloyd.
Oh, I'm not. I wouldn't, believe me. Strictly his terminology.
Well, I say it's a bookshelf and I say it's a pain in the neck.
The Roswell G. Hello, Mrs. Flemington. Yes, Mr. Flemington is in, but he's taking his mid-morning nap. Mm-hmm. In his quarters. His office. Yeah, that's right, with his phone unplugged. Would you care to leave a message? Uh-huh. Okay, I see. I'll tell him.
Here it comes!
Oh, cover your ears, boys!
Let's get with it, Conklin! A tight office is a happy office. Idle hands make for an unproductive poop deck.
Yes, sir.
What are you doing, Miss Abernathy?
Just putting on my lipstick, sir. That is, Captain.
Belay that! Extraneous activity is nothing more nor less than sloppy seamanship, in a manner of speaking. You there! Fenced mocker!
Aye, aye.
Keep an even keel, in a manner of speaking. Let's keep an even keel here, man. To all of you, bear in mind that we must, all of us, go aft. Climb up the old mast, in a manner of speaking, and set our sights on a distant horizon.
Got it, sir.
A tight ship, a happy ship. Damn the torpedoes of competition. And full speed ahead.
Aye, aye, Captain.
This is Roswell G. Flemington. 220 pounds of gristle, lung tissue, and sound decibels. He is, as you may have perceived, a noisy man, one of a breed who substitute volume for substance, sound for significance, and shouting to cover up the readily apparent phenomenon that he is nothing more than an overweight and aging perennial sea scout, whose noisemaking is in inverse ratio to his competence and character. But soon, our would-be admiral of the fleet will embark on another voyage, this one in an unchartered and twisting course, headed for a distant port called the Twilight Zone.
And now, the Twilight Zone and our story, Sounds and Silences, starring Richard Kind, with Stacey Keach as your narrator.
Ah, clear skies, visibility unlimited. And now, for something a bit more bracing. You may enter.
I forgot to tell you, sir.
Yes? What? Speak up.
I forgot to tell you that your wife called.
Oh, she did she?
Yes, a little while ago. She's on the phone again now. Would you like to take the call?
Oh, I suppose so. See how the home fires are burning.
What's that?
I said I'll plug in the extension.
Yes, sir.
Here, madam. Yes? Yes? What noise? Oh, well, it's a most excellent recording, actually. Flight sounds of aircraft leaving the carrier Hornet. Now I can't turn it down. It has to be heard at realistic levels. Speak up! What is your request? Talk! About what, pray tell? Well, then talk away! Very well, later. Of course I shall be home for dinner. Yes, of course, I'm quite sure. Goodbye!
Naval aircraft, I presume.
Someone should fire a volley at his starboard side.
Ugh, no shooting, please. My ears are ringing already.
If you ask me, I'd say Captain Bly is a few hours away from a mutiny.
He'll have to walk the plank.
Old fat boy? Where would you find a plank big enough to hold him?
All those kamikazes they threw at us during the war, wouldn't you think just one of them would have hit him?
One of these days, all that noise is gonna come back and bite him. I just hope I'm around to see it happen.
All ashore! I'm home! Ah, Navy rum. To be followed later by a full measure of grog. But first, some easy listening on the stereo. Which album shall it be tonight? Sounds of submarine warfare? Great squalls of the North Atlantic? Cruising on a windjammer? Engine rooms of the great destroyer? No. Wait. Here it is. Perfect!
Down just a little bit.
I beg pardon?
I say, I can't hear a thing on the telephone.
You know what that is, my dear? It's a collector's item. This is an actual recording of the battleship Missouri bombing Okinawa.
That may be, Roswell, but I can't hear who's on the phone.
Ah! Lay on, gentlemen! Let them know what's what. Fire at will, and by the good Lord Harry, we'll show them how a man's Navy treats aggression.
Who did you say is calling? Who? Just a minute. I'm afraid you'll have to call back.
Woman! What have you done?
Called a truce in the Pacific.
You've ruined the record. That, madam, constitutes an act of utter abomination and the most callous vandalism. I would remind you...
I would remind you that I live in this house, too.
That there were only 100 such recordings pressed for the collector's market. As rare can be.
Well, now there are only 99.
Absolutely irreplaceable. What you have just done is an act of wanton desecration. Not unlike the defacing of John Paul Jones's statue. What are you, madam? Some kind of crazed peace fanatic?
Roswell, we've had this out before. I'm not the fanatic around here.
I must say, your meaning eludes me.
Perhaps I should use semaphore signals. This insistence on blaring noises and running a household like it was a destroyer escort on convoy duty. This combination has now become quite impossible.
Nonsense!
That's why we have to talk.
We are talking! And if I read you correctly, you have grown intolerant of my ways. In point of fact, you hold my very business in contempt.
Not your business, you. The way you run your business and this ship-shape home.
Ah, so you disapprove of the nautical decor. I'll have you know that every item is of enormous value. Enormous. From the ship's wheel at the helm.
It's not a helm, Roswell. It's a living room.
To the sails and riggings.
They're curtains made out of canvas according to your orders. Old canvas.
To the life preservers on the walls. All obtained at great expense. With profits from the selfsame company that has kept you in good stead for so many years.
Well, I can't live with it anymore.
How's that?
Oh, knock it off, Roswell.
Stand down, madam.
You're a noisy, insufferable clown, but you're not stupid. I have had it up to here, and my ears have had it, and my stomach lining has had it, and whatever part of the brain that keeps a person balanced, that's had it too. In short, I have had it. I'm leaving.
By the good Lord Harry.
Departing a sinking ship, you might say. And don't tell me how sudden this is, because as you well know, we have been en route to this point for the last 20 years. I can't bear to be at sea any longer.
I am totally and absolutely astounded.
Are you now?
I am indeed. My own wife, and after 20 years.
20 years ago, I was not taken in marriage. I was piped aboard. And after 20 years, the piping has become shrill and unbearable. It has destroyed me, my nerves, and my sanity. So, at this point, Roswell, I'm leaving, in a manner of speaking, the ship's company.
So, you're deserting me?
In a manner of speaking, Roswell, you said it.
Lydia! Lydia, don't you lock me out of our own bedroom!
It wasn't locked, Roswell.
It may interest you to know, madam.
Don't shake your finger at me.
That when I was a young chap, a mere cabin boy, you might say, I had a mother who insisted that she was perpetually ill. A whiny, petulant, complaining woman similar to yourself.
Oh, this is too much.
And when I would come home from school, she made me walk tiptoe and whisper in her presence. Whisper, whisper, whisper. Whisper. Do you know that in our house we never had any cookies? Just soft fudge brownies, because they made less noise when you chewed them. Eat your brownie and then run upstairs, change your clothes, but keep it quiet. And I tell you, madam, I took quite enough of it. That is why I went to sea, and that is why I've spent my life in the very wholesome, healthy, quite understandable pursuit of the free and the unfettered. Strip off the cotton and the insulation, and let the sounds of the earth come in. And so now I am owner, manager, chairman of the board, and president of the Roswell G. Flemington Model Ship Company. Second to none in the field.
Whose motto is, damn the torpedoes, full steam ahead for fun and profits. I know the company, I know the president, I know the motto. And I respond, Mr. Roswell G. Flemington, with the following nautical phrase, which I have now taken to heart and will proceed to implement. The phrase is, lay aft and dump the garbage. So, in a manner of speaking, consider yourself dumped.
Sounds of a three-masted schooner in the South Pacific. Perfect. Good riddance, madam. If the truth be known, I have never liked you. I have simply suffered your presence. If there is one thing that sticks in my craw, that thing is a landlubber. So, madam, in a manner of speaking, get ashore. Do you hear me? Get ashore now! I have never, mark you, I have never in my entire life felt so free, so unencumbered, so absolutely fulfilled. In the parlance of naval language, in a manner of speaking, the situation is 4.0. My decks have finally been cleared. I intend to enjoy myself topside for the rest of the evening. And at precisely 10 bells, I shall retire to my sleeping quarters. But until then, this is my watch! At long last! At long last I can see to the far horizon! And a life of wonderful, delightful noise! Now, where's my karaoke machine? Anchors away, my lad! Anchors away! What? What? A leak in the cargo hold? All hands on deck! Oh, where's it coming from? The blasted bathroom sink. There. The shower. Off, I say, off! How do you turn off this wretched alarm clock? Oh, my deck seemed to be, in a matter of speaking, listing a bit. Where are my navy-cut cigarettes? I must be dreaming! Go around! Go around! Pass, you imbecile! That's right! Run the red light! No noise laws in this city at all anymore. Any rattletrap is permitted on the streets. At last, my turn to make my way through the flotsam and jetsam.
You there, pull over. License and registration.
Certainly, officer. Happy to oblige. My duty is a civilian. Here you are.
Mr. Flemington?
Roswell G. Flemington, of the Flemington Model Ship Company. Perhaps you've heard of us. Purveyors of the finest in maritime collectibles. A Navy man, are you? Coast Guard? Merchant Marine?
Something wrong with your car.
Why, no. No, not at all, thank the good Lord Harry. Now, this boat has kept me afloat for many years now. Hydromatic V8 with overdrive. Though the engine seems to produce a most curious sound this morning. Like a motorboat every time I step on the gas. No, it's more like a tug, I should say. Like a tug hauling an ocean liner to the dock.
On your way to work, are you?
I am indeed. And if you wish to cite me for speeding, you'll have difficulty proving it in court. A great deal of difficulty. At no time have I exceeded 15 knots. Point of fact, that's an impossibility. Considering the sounds of strain emitted by this engine...
I didn't stop you for speeding, sir.
Oh, good, good. Well, I'll be on my way.
I stopped you because you were going so slow.
You did? Oh. Oh, I see. Well, then that's all very well, then.
Why are you driving so far under the speed limit?
Why? It's as I said. This craft obviously has a few bolts loose somewhere. I tell you, I've never heard such a racket from the engine room.
Then I'd suggest you take her into port somewhere. There's a gas station on the next block. They do repairs. But frankly, sir, the car sounded just fine to me. A real classic. You got a cherry piece of Detroit iron here. Lots of horses under the hood, huh? Yeah, anyway... Try to keep up with the flow of traffic, would you, Mr. Flemington? Good day to you.
Oh, I been here 2 years, and I don't know when I'll get used to that thing.
I've been here 4 years, and I've never gotten used to it.
What do you suppose happened to old Lardhead this morning?
You should count your blessings. This is the first time he's ever been late.
Wouldn't it be awesome if his car had fallen off the ferry boat with him in it?
The peak. The absolute peak.
Thus endeth the dream.
Good morning, Mr. Flemp.
That's the first time he's walked in without telling me that the smoking lamp was not lit and we had to move full speed ahead toward the shores of prosperity.
Maybe he's sick.
Something incurable, like barnacles on the brain.
That's very odd. That's very, very odd. I've been here 10 years, and that's the first time he's ever looked frightened.
Something restful. Restful. Actual sounds of Hawaiian outrigger canoes. Yes. Yes.
Ye gods! This record is defective!
Fresh air. That's what we need. The great outdoors. The smell of salt spray in our nostrils. Blow me down. Conklin! What are you doing, man?
Me? Just pouring a glass of water from the water cooler, that's all.
Well, let's keep it quiet out here.
Yes, sir.
Now what are you doing?
Swallowing, Mr. Flemington. I was thirsty.
Quietly, I said. Quietly. Now stop gaping. Get back to work. All of you. Mr. Fenstmacher!
Begging your pardon, sir. New shoes.
What have you gotten them? Dead fish? Oh, people! This ship has to shape up. Repeat, shape up! Noise pollution hinders efficiency. Let's secure the hatches now. And mind the torrent of bilge. Oh! What is going on? By the good Lord, Harry! What on earth is going on?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well?
Nothing abnormal that I can see, Mr. Flemington. No excess wax, no obstruction of any kind in the inner or outer ear.
You mean no sign of infection? Nothing at all?
Not even inflammation.
Candor dictates that I tell you, Doctor, that as a ship surgeon, you're a wash. You wouldn't make cabin boy, in a manner of speaking.
I take it, Mr. Flemington, that you expected me to find something wrong with you.
I told you the symptoms, haven't I?
You have. An apparent auditory distortion.
Apparent! Shoes that sound like pipe organs played underwater. A leaky faucet sounds like barrels over Niagara Falls. And I wish you could have seen me cross 48th and 6th today. The traffic noise has nearly keel-hauled me. It was considerably more than a distortion.
I don't know what to say without any outward signs.
Well, I know what to say. Now hear this, Doctor. There is obviously something askew in my crow's nest, in a manner of speaking. Now, will you prescribe the appropriate medication for my affliction, or do you force me to seek safe harbor elsewhere?
Frankly, Mr. Flemington, I think consulting another physician might be a practical idea. Extremely practical.
Very well, then. But if you had a modicum of professional ethics, you would have given me this advice before going through the motions of a perfunctory examination. As it is, I'll now be done for your bill as well as another ear specialist's.
Mr. Flemington, I wasn't going to recommend another ear specialist. I had in mind, perhaps some psychiatric help.
A psychiatrist, huh? I will make a presumption that you are being humorous. It is that charitable outlook that saves your being called to account, sir.
The soundest recommendation I can make under the circumstances.
I can assure you, Doctor, and I use the term loosely,
that there are few people today on land or sea who are as sane as I am. I bid you good day.
Good day to you, and good luck.
Oh, what is that hideous sound?
I'm merely making a few notes on your chart, see? Nothing to be afraid of. An ordinary number 2 pencil, that's all.
Oh! Oh!
Do you have to be so piercing with that rose?
Sorry, Mama.
Well, you've done a beautiful job setting the table.
You can sit down now, Mama.
Oh, you're a good girl, Rosie. You know I'd cook Thanksgiving dinner if I could, but with my allergies and my arthritis and my bursitis and my ear infection, not to mention my spastic colon, well, it's all I can do to make it downstairs.
I know, Mama.
You may call your brother now.
Roswell!
Not so loud, dear.
I'm sorry.
Roswell, would you please not ride your pogo stick in the house?
All right. No running. You know what Mama said. Okay.
Roswell?
Yes, ma'am?
Are you wearing shoes?
Uh-huh.
Roswell?
Okay.
Carefully.
All right.
Now take your seat, Roswell. You too, Rose. Who'd like to say grace?
I will.
Go ahead.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this food that my sister has set before us, and especially the pie, which I hope she remembered to make for dessert.
A silent prayer, Roswell.
Oh, yeah.
Pass the mashed potatoes, please.
Yes, Mama.
And the cranberry sauce, and the yams, and the creamed corn, and the creamed spinach, and the tofu.
Can I carve the turkey?
Oh, there's no need. This year we boiled it till it's so tender it slides right off the bone. So much nicer without all that hacking and sawing. Doesn't it look scrumptious?
Yeah. Here, have a roll, Roswell. Thanks. Hey, how come it's so soft?
Rosie only put them in the oven for a minute so they wouldn't be too crunchy. Easier on the nerves.
Did you make the pie?
Tapioca, but there's lots of whipped cream.
Grab hold.
What's that?
A wishbone. Grab hold and pull.
I don't know.
Go on.
What are you children doing? And what's that in your hand? Oh, my heart. You gave me such a fright. I'd better lie down.
But we got her good with the wishbone. Oh, didn't we? She thought she'd been shot with a harpoon.
Won't you enjoy that?
Ha ha. It was the best Thanksgiving ever. Oh, the rules she had. Did I mention that we only used paper plates and plastic forks after that?
See.
Out with the pogo stick. I padded around in socks from the moment I got home from school. The radio was permitted only with headphones. The telephone had no ring, just a little red light. My toothbrush, soft bristles. No toast, only soft boiled eggs. No ice cubes in the refrigerator, not even chunky peanut butter. And all my school books had to be paperback, in case I accidentally dropped one on the floor.
Go on.
As soon as I was old enough, I ran away and joined the Navy.
What happened to your sister?
Oh, she became a sign language interpreter for the National Theater of the Deaf.
Mm. Well, I should say that about covers it.
It does?
Now do you understand, Mr. Flemington?
Understand what, Doctor?
Unless I'm very much mistaken, it's a phenomenon we in the psychiatric profession call autosuggestion.
Nothing to do with motor cars, I presume.
A person talks himself into believing that certain occurrences take place, when in reality, they are pure figments of the imagination. Beyond that, there are some suggestions that you were very resentful of your mother and her preoccupation with her imaginary aches and pains.
You don't say.
My guess would be that this feeling now extends to your wife, who very similarly provides you with a mother image.
Ah, uh-huh.
But I can tell you this, Mr. Flemington, and forgive me if I repeat myself, these occurrences are only figments of your imagination.
Yeah, but if that's so, then...
Snap your fingers.
Do I dare?
Go ahead, snap your fingers. Any abnormal sound?
None.
Now, stamp your feet on the floor. Normal?
Happily, delightfully normal.
Now, let's really put it to the test.
You've cured me, Doctor! By the good Lord, Harry, if Admiral Nelson had had you at Trafalgar, he'd have kept both his eye and his arm. In Navy parlance, Doctor, you, sir, are 4.0. 4.0, sir, in a manner of speaking. Ha ha ha! I'm free to go.
Free as a bird. Und slam the door at will on your way out. Be my guest.
I shall.
You, sir, you have the soul of a seaman. Bless you.
Any more patients today?
No, Doctor. That was the last one.
Praise Freud. Why do I get all the nutcases?
Incredible. Absolutely incredible. My own wife, the culprit. Her miserable preoccupation with noise. She planted that seed in my head. Incredible. Incredible what one crew member can do to a ship's company. Absolutely incredible. And the whole thing. Mind over matter. Land ho! You are not welcome on this particular quarter deck, madam.
Nor shall I stay here, Admiral. I forgot some of my things. I came to retrieve same, and now, whether you pipe me ashore or not, that's precisely where I'm headed.
I might add, madam, that despite all your efforts to capsize this worthy vessel, in a manner of speaking, against the rocks and shoals of petulance and pettiness, this ship remains tight. Your efforts have been both worthless and wasteful.
Horatio, old pal, let the following be my final comments. You are an overgrown sailor boy with an undermanned head. You are full of such neuroses that I wonder how you haven't cracked before this.
Belay that! Belay that, woman! It just so happens that I have had a psychiatric evaluation. And if there is anything wrong with me, it is you. Furthermore, madam, the whole business is simply mind over matter. Absolutely and totally. Do you know what I can do? I can shut you off. I am a man of such incredible will that I can shut you off. Go ahead! Yell at me. Yell! Because even at this moment, I am in the process of exercising mind over matter. I am shutting you completely out.
Flemington, I wonder about you. I wonder why no one has committed you. I really do.
Ha! See? See? I have shut you off. Go ahead. Talk all you like.
Really, Roswell, you need help. You really do.
Mind over matter. I want to shut her out. I simply shut her out.
Now, let's see. What'll I listen to tonight? Anchors Away? The Midshipman's March? Actual sounds of a Japanese destroyer exploding in the Pacific, complete with boiler hissings, fantail cracking, and smokestack blowing apart. Ha ha! Only great, huh? Better prepare yourselves, neighbors. This one will galvanize you in the proper manner. Something wrong with the record player? Better turn the volume up. All the way. Must be the speakers. Why is everything so quiet? What's wrong out there? I can't hear the city. Hey, out there! Hey! Hey, what's going on? Why can't I hear anything?
Louder! I want it louder! More noise! More noise out there! Let's hear it! Come on! Louder! Louder! Help me, someone! Help me!
When last heard from, Mr. Roswell G. Flemington was in a sanitarium, pleading with the medical staff to make some noise, any kind of noise. They, of course, believed the case to be a rather tragic aberration, a man's mind coming inexplicably unhinged. And for this, they'll give him pills, therapy, rest, and lots of peace and quiet. Little do they realize that all Mr. Flemington is suffering from is a case of poetic justice. Tonight's tale of Sounds and Silences from the Twilight Zone.
Sounds and Silences, starring Richard Kind, with Stacy Keach as your narrator, was adapted for radio by Dennis Etchison and based on a script by Rod Serling. Heard in the cast were Maggie Carney, David Darlow, Richard Shavsden, Peggy Roeder, Sarah Marks, Carl Amari, Doug James, C.J. Amari, James Schneider, and Amanda Amari. The producers of The Twilight Zone wish to thank CBS Enterprises, Carol Serling, Dennis Etchison, Dick Brescia Associates, Claire Simon Casting, Terry Jennings, XM Satellite Radio, the American Forces Radio and Television Service, Sirius Satellite Radio, our sponsors and our radio affiliates for helping make this series possible. This radio series is produced and directed by Carl Amari and Roger Wolski for Falcon Picture Group. Doug James speaking.